looking for the King of Podcasts? You're at the wrong channel. Looking for good ideas for life? You are far from good hands. If you think the listener is always right, you are far from the right place. Hosted by a Northeasterner by birth, a rebel by choice. If you want a host that floats between love and madness, then play on and listen to Crazy Train Radio.
What up, Crazy Train Radio?
You want answers? I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth!
You can't handle the truth!
I love scotch. I love scotch. Scotch is got scotch. Here it goes down. Down into my belly.
Don't mess with me, I'm one crazy mofo.
Thinking your day is bad and really looking to make it worse? Why not try downloading this new classic set of music that will be dropping so far off the charts there's bound to be injuries. Now that's what I call depressing. It's gonna make those who are even close to having the slightest glimmer of hope wanna jump off the highest of planks. For those that are getting Now That's What I Call Depressing, you'll be getting that song that reminds you of that relationship with those cougars, Wrinkled Ladies. For those who weren't really into cougars, but those who had that special friend whilst in Cell Block 2B, we got for you this clusterfuck that will put you in therapy for years to come. With cheeks wide open. Who the fuck writes this shit? Oh hell, we're still recording this commercial.
Always with you, it cannot be done.
Those that rather have it out than in. This loaded hit will be dropping soon, farthing in the USA. For those who place their order by calling or ordering online, the next 100 folks will receive their choice of either a deuce of good quality that won't snap, an installation of a new outlet next to your bathtub so you can now blow dry your hair in a full tub, or the choice of the right gang to just beat the fuck out of you. Call us today at 1-800-FUCK-THIS.
Hey, I know we have a lot of horror fans that listen to our shows, and I know things have been tough for everybody across the board these past 6 or 7 months with what's been going on in the real world, but I wanted to make a suggestion to you horror fans, because I know part of the normal routine year in and year out is to attend different conventions to meet some of your favorite horror stars. However, none of us have been able to do that because of obvious reasons. But I do have a little suggestion for you. SignatureHorror.com. Now, some may ask, what is that? Well, they obtain autographs for the fans from some of their favorite stars, from some of their favorite franchises. Whether it be the original Texas Chainsaw Massacre, Friday the 13th, Nightmare on Elm Street, and many more. They have different options such as, besides getting their autographs, you can do live Zoom calls with your favorite stars. You can do personalized videos for people, greetings of some sort. They just have many options. So if you're looking for to spend some money that you may have spent at conventions, check them out and see the options they have. SignatureHorror.com. That's right, SignatureHorror.com.
Hi, it's Rhonda Shear, and I know all of you remember me from USA Up All Night. Now, you're only cool if you're listening to Crazy Train Radio. I know I do.
Hey folks, it's your least favorite host in the podcast world, Croc, Jonathan Steele.
And I'm Elena, your favorite host from the Emerald Isles.
And boy, do we have a good one for you today. This next guest actually was Miss Louisiana back in 1975. But there's a lot more than looks for this lovely lady who is on the line now, as she also, from what I read, and we know everything on the internet is true, a bachelor's degree in communications from a school down in Louisiana there as well. This guest has had an extensive career in the entertainment industry, and early on was connected to such an awesome person to have as a mentor in Joan Rivers, who, how can you not love Joan? Might not make it in today's environment, but Joan was a special lady. But anyway, this guest started learning from her when she was diving into comedy, but she is best known for hosting USA's Up All Night for over 450 episodes. And over the years, has parlayed her entertainment career by becoming a very successful mogul behind one of the most popular intimate apparel brands in women's clothing. This guest, Rhonda Shear. Rhonda, how are you doing?
Oh, that's such a sweet introduction. Thank you so much. So sweet.
Well, I guess I'll start here. How have you been spending COVID and stuff? I know you got your hands in several different pots. But
I do.
What have you been doing?
I have to stay busy or I'm crazed or depressed, and I don't want to be either one of those. So I'm a very positive thinker. So Well, first of all, through COVID, you know, my brand, along with RhondaShear.com and Zulily and Amazon, we sell on HSN, which is Home Shopping Network, and TSC, which is the Canadian shopping channel. So they're huge customers of ours. I mean, they really run the brand, at least HSN, in terms of the amount that they buy. So, you know, we're vendors, which means that they buy from us, and then I go on air and I sell my product. And it takes about a year to develop products. So we have, you know, about 5,000 different items and SKUs in our brand. So anyway, long story short, I go on HSN, but they shut down their studios back in March because of COVID. And guests then would have to Skype in. I was actually the first guest to do it. I love it. I mean, I love Skyping in from my house. And my husband has created basically a television studio here. It's pretty cool. Like, we have cameras, we have lighting. We've created a set within our house, and so I get to sell my products several hours a month on air. So that's one of the things I'm doing, and I love doing that because I would be doing it at the studio, which is located here in Florida. I'm in St. Petersburg, Florida, but it's cool to be able just to do it from your home. then we also, I decided to create a talk show, and I first started just doing it just to speak to friends. It was kind of like a Facebook Live thing. And then we found that we could create a website and we could air it on YouTube and on Facebook and on Twitter simultaneously through StreamYard, a streaming service we use. So I have two producers, and the show's getting really sophisticated. So we had, you know, we do it every Saturday night at 9 p.m. It's called RhondaShearSocialHour.com. I mean, Rhonda Shear Social Hour. You can find it on RhondaShearSocialHour.com. And we've done just tons of episodes now. And I've had Gilbert Gottfried on. I just had Judy Tenuta. And I've had the Scream Queens on. And gorgeous ladies of wrestling. And producers and directors and artists and perfumers and you name it. And I love doing it. I love it. I mean, it kind of goes back to my roots of interviewing people and hosting. And so I've been doing that. We're also going to reboot Up All Night our own way. We already have six films that are not, you know, public domain, that are actually real films that have been, you know, either distributed or they're friends of ours films that they're allowing us to borrow for our reboot of Up All Night, I should say. And so we're working on that. We have a lot of irons in the fire, as you said, and I actually have two reality shows being shopped around too. And I wasn't even looking for these things. I just think that people are kind of bored and they're looking for things too. So, hey, why not? It's time to be creative.
Well, I'll start with the clothing line first and foremost. Now, I've heard in other places you say that the lingerie business has been your favorite part of your career. Why would you say that's been your favorite part?
Well, I mean, I just think that I've always loved designing. I didn't go to school for it, but, you know, even as a Miss Louisiana, I used to design my own costumes and evening gowns. And then when I hit LA, I used to love, you know, I love design. I should have majored in it, but I didn't. But so I would just, you know, either shop for really interesting outfits and did my own wardrobe on Up All Night for all those years and did it on different shows through all the years. It was really funny. I was always lending out my clothing to other actresses all through my years in LA. But when I hit Up All Night and they wanted me to keep people tuned into cheesy films, which are like really popular now, but they were popular then, but, you know, they still wanted that host to keep people tuned in to basically the commercials as well. So I ended up deciding that if I spent a lot of time in intimate apparel, that people would definitely be tuned in. So I wore a lot of cute bras and panties and slips and all kinds of cute things, along with some really great outfits. And I changed about five times a show. That was kind of my mantra, was to change wardrobe during the show to also keep viewers entertained. So that being said, after spending a lot of time in intimate apparel and bras and panties and cute little outfits, they weren't so comfortable. So years later, when I reunited with my husband, who is my high school sweetheart.
And thank you, classmates.com.
Yep. I'll get into that a little bit. But when we reunited, we decided, we really didn't think it through. He was living in Louisiana and I was living in LA. And we didn't really, you know, he was in business and I was still acting, but I wasn't up all night anymore. So he said, what do you want to do? Is there anything you want to do? And I said, I love an intimate apparel business. So it kind of started from there. And he's a businessman, and with his help and his background is business and my design, we started, and it just kind of started slowly and just took off from there.
Yeah, unfortunately, my co-host is dealing with tech issues, and hopefully will join in. So she was actually going to ask some of the questions about the clothing line.
Oh, I love you talking panties and bras. It's awesome.
Yeah, but, you know, what I was going to say, or ask anyway, is obviously I'm not your customer base, but...
Hey, well,
and I'm not judging anybody. It's 2020. You know, it's hey,
there's a lot of guys that buy for their wives and partners and mothers and other
or themselves
things as well. And we don't judge either.
Yeah. But what would you, in terms of your apparel, what makes yours different than if one were to go to, say, buy a Victoria's Secret or the countless other brands that are out there?
Well, we're very different from Victoria's Secret. We cater to all shapes and sizes. So you know, the mantra, and I used to be a Victoria's Secret shopper in my youth, is pretty much as a younger model. So we hit all ages, you know, just from young gals all the way to be 100 and love our products. So we're about comfort and value and, you know, longevity of products, sustainability, the things that we make are not, you know, as we like to say, 1 minute lingerie that men like and buy for Valentine's Day. So we do really beautiful things that women love. And, you know, because everybody needs a good pair of underwear, even guys, yes, and bras if you're a woman. And so we do things that are, you know, that fit literally from, we take people from all sizes, like from extra small to 5X, which is, you know, a full size range. And you can't find that in most department stores, in most brands. So that's one thing that makes us unique, plus our price point. Plus, you know, that we just have this very wide range of intimate apparel and apparel. So it isn't just the sassy, sexy things. I mean, you know, I think all stores have their place. They're not competitors. They're just, you know, we do shapewear too. We do loungewear. So just different. We're just different. You know, we're all different. There's a lot of stores out there. There's room for all of us, a lot of brands. But it's, I think, being a woman designing for women and getting that people are looking for comfort, for value, for quality, for something that lasts a long time, is what our line's about.
Well, for those who want to look at the products, we'll mention it again, rhondashear.com, that's for sure. And she has lengths and sizing charts and just all the information you would need.
And great sales going on. Great sales.
Yes. Well, for, like we said, rhondashear.com, if they want to visit the site, see what kind of products you have to offer. There's sizing charts. There's everything you need to know in one spot to try to find best. Hey, I'm trying, you know.
No, you're doing great. I created a bra called the Abra many years ago.
Yes.
And it's a very famous bra that sold over 35 million worldwide. I'm going to change rooms again because my husband's on the phone. So I have to kind of move around a little bit during this interview. Going outside now. Oh, it's chilly outside here in Florida today. It's kind of nice. What was I saying?
You were talking about the opera.
Oh, yeah, the Abra. So we sold 35 million in 34 countries, and that was back in 2012. And that led our company to massive awards. I mean, we won major awards in the world of design and creativity and Ernst & Young and fastest growing female owned company. And, you know, it was just amazing. And I had been, you know, I come from the world of acting and comedy. So it was very unique then to move into being an entrepreneur and being honored for being an entrepreneur. And so I've helped a lot of up and coming entrepreneurs of all ages that have different products, not necessarily intimate apparel, but just whatever their products may be, get their products to market, because we had to learn on our own. Because my husband came from the software industry, and even though it was his company, it was still a different model, although mm-hmm. business is business. And it's been interesting. I have a book too, and it's called Up All Night, but it's from lingerie mogul to from lingerie, I forget the whole name of it. It's a long name. Yes. But basically, it's called Up All Night, Life Lessons from an Accidental Feminist. So pick it up. You can pick it up on rhondashear.com or on Amazon. If you get it through rhondashear.com, it becomes signed. And what's great about the book is it really takes you through not only my career and Hollywood and some really great stories, but it also takes you through what it takes to be an entrepreneur. It gives tips for anybody trying to go into business or wanting to go into business.
Well, that's for sure. I know I'll be picking up a copy. I'm sure it's.
We'll get you out one. We will get you out a book for sure.
Okay. Well, we will take care of that off air. But before we get into the entertainment side of things, got to ask, because said it in the introduction there. How now? Because like I said, everything on the online is true. But what I had read is you met Joan, Miss Rivers, at a doctor's office. But how did you get that? That's what it said. It's amazing. But how did you actually? It is true then.
Uh-huh. That is true. The very first time I met her.
So.
I went to, I was getting a nose job. Or at least I was getting consultation for getting my nose fixed, because I was told by casting directors that my nose was lovely, but to be even better for, you know, for certain roles, to be a leading woman, I would have to have a little bit taken off the top. So I was having consultation, and Joan Rivers was in the same office, which immediately was sitting there in the waiting room with her dog in her lap in the doctor's office. And I of course had to say something to her, because she was my idol. And she was very funny. And she goes, "You're beautiful, darling. You need nothing." She goes, "And turn to the side." And I turned to the side. She goes, "Yeah, maybe just a little bit off the top, and you'll even be more beautiful." She was so cute. And that's not where I, you know, that is where I met her. But it was years later when I was put on her show by a producer friend. And he was producing one of, and he was very young, but he was one of the co-producers on her talk show, one of her talk shows. And then that's when, you know, we became a little bit friendlier, and she would use me over and over on her talk show and her radio shows. So she was very, very giving.
Yeah, she, and you're not the only person to say this. I know I'm a big Howard Stern fan, and she was a frequent guest of Howard's.
Yes, and, yes.
You know, just, but
he
many
respected her, which
oh,
is great.
Absolutely. But not just him, but there's been countless people when you talk stand up comedy, but just entertainment and business. Mm-hmm. Talk the entertainment business in general. Mm-hmm. Joan's name always comes up as a top, I guess you could say, Mount Rushmore of people. When you talk about just because of what she did, how funny she was.
No, but she was very giving. She was very giving to other performers. She would give advice. She would give tips. She also, I've talked to other comics that would tell me that she would actually go over their sets for like the Tonight Show and help them, you know, jazz it up or fix it or really hone it. And people won't do that. She was one of a kind. And, you know, I don't know Melissa well. I know her, like I could email her, you know, or text her, but she's a lovely woman too. So she did really well. And she should have been, Johnny Carson should have given the throne to her as a Tonight Show, but they know they had a falling out. And I think he was a bit jealous of her ratings, because when she would fill in back there in the
80s
for him. Yeah. I don't think he liked it. I love when she filled in. I loved her. I didn't love her over him, but I just thought she had a unique style and would have done very well in the night. You know, still to this day, there's been no female that's done that, who's reigned in the evening.
Yeah, but like you were saying there, yeah, she wasn't, and I was going to mention, she wasn't afraid to reach her hand up and help pull others up to try to.
No, I love doing that too. I think when you do that, it only helps yourself. And I think it just, I think you learn by younger people. I think you learn by helping people. And there's nothing better than, I mean, I've helped a gazillion people and I don't get anything in return for it. I don't want anything in return. It just, sometimes I see people and I go, wow, if this person and that person got together, they could make some magic. So I don't know. I just kind of have that in me too, that generosity. I don't know why I really do. No, I love helping young. I mean, when I go back and look at my Up All Night series, and I see the comics that were on there and the talent that was on there. I mean, it allowed a lot of people just to have, hey, you want to take this box too? Sorry. It allowed a lot of people to, you know, to get started and to get footage and to get some of their first videotapes.
Exactly.
That they could use for, you know, so it's a great feel good moment to help talent. And sometimes people just can't get a break. So if you can be the one to do it, and she was like that. So Joan was very giving, and she left us far too soon. And I think she would have done very well in this era, even though it is so politically correct. I think she would have managed to find a way.
You know,
I think it would have been great, because we need more people that, like Joan, would have said, "Hey, I'm saying it like it is, and I don't care." Mm-hmm. And we need that.
You know, it's folks
lost
like
the humor.
I'm only 36, but I think when. And you bring up a good thing as far as the time we're currently in. I'd always be curious, and we won't get the answer, but it'd be interesting to see what would Joan be saying? What would Carlin be saying? Richard Pryor, just of those unique top, you know, that level of comedy, what would these folks be saying?
Yeah, they wouldn't have sat down. They wouldn't have taken it very well. They wouldn't have. The problem is that, oh, I'm sorry. There's so much distraction. Hey, sorry. You can cut this out or you can leave it in. Anyway, I think she would have like done her own thing, and I think Carlin would have, but you know, the problem is, and I've spoken at universities. I mean, I haven't been doing stand up in the last few years, but I've spoken at a lot of universities, and the kids, I think it's because they are on their phones, and I'm guilty of it too, but of course I didn't come from that. But I think that they only know how to communicate through phones and iPads and computers now, that they don't know what's funny anymore. So like, I mean, I was speaking at school and I was, you know, inserting a lot of humor into my speech. And I look at these kind of dead faces out there. I mean, maybe one or two people were smiling. And I mean, I knew I was saying funny stuff. And I'm like, I actually said, hey, that was funny what I just said. You can laugh. Once I told them it was okay to laugh, they did. Well, it's almost like, it's either like they're afraid to laugh or they don't know what's funny anymore, or both.
Exactly. But yeah, just the old school body of me would be curious to know what.
It's like, it's really sad. Maybe after this COVID thing, this is my opinion, and I've had this discussion with other people and other writers and performers, that I don't know if there'll be a big return to movie theaters because we're kind of used to being home and being able to stream whatever we want. But I think that a lot of theaters will turn into small entertainment venues and live venues. I think that is the one thing we can't get at home, is we can't have the experience of live entertainment. So I think that you'll be seeing more bands and more music and maybe smaller stand-up and improvisational. I think there's going to be plays. I think there's going to be a yearning for live performance after we're able to come out of the darkness. and I think there'll be a switch in this, and maybe there'll be a throwback to being able to say what you want. I hope so.
Yeah.
I don't get the whole politically correcting. I don't.
Me neither.
It's actually become kind of political, like if you're on the left or the right. And I don't get that either. I mean, I'm sorry. Just I missed something. And somehow I've missed something. Like, why did we have to become, you know, why can't we kid about ourselves? We've all, you know, making fun of yourself is that's what I did on stage. I would do a little bit making fun of myself, a little put down. And then that makes the audience go, oh, okay. You know, they're thinking what you're thinking. So I feel like if you suppress speech or you suppress humor, you've got a lot of frustrated people, and then people become angry, and then you lose humor. And once you lose humor, I don't know. Humor to me is the basis of everything. You need to be able, you need levity even in times of darkness like this.
Yeah.
Okay, terrific.
Take two, folks, which is, you know, we drop a Zoom call and 2.5
yes.
months later, here we are.
My life is so crazy. It seemed like last week, so it's all good.
Yeah, it's this new technology called the internet, folks. Take it for what it is worth. So let's pick up here if we can.
Okay.
And Up All Night, the TV show.
Yes.
So how did you get involved, and what was that process like to start with?
Well, I had been acting for a lot of years, because that was in 1991 that I was cast in that. So, you know, I moved out to L.A. in 78, so late 78. So a lot of years I had under my belt and a lot of television, and I had fallen in love with stand-up comedy and comedy. And I kept getting told over and over that I was too sexy to be funny, or too pretty to be funny, or too attractive. And I was like, oh, I'm so over this. So I kept trying to change and go against type and play, you know, really downplay whatever people thought they were seeing in me, and tone it down. And then finally, my agent, you know, said they're replacing a gal that's been on this show. It's a hosted movie thing. You know, you host movies, B films. It's a good gig. It's with the USA Network. It's a new, pretty new basic cable network. And they're looking for a lot of sex appeal. They don't think the girl that's there has it like what they want anyway. I thought that she was very pretty, the gal before me. But anyway, that wasn't for me to say. You know, that's what they were looking for, somebody new. And so I was, you know, I set up to meet the producers and met them. And all these other women basically came into the interview dressed like a host. Like back then, a newscaster host would be like more suited. That was more of a look. So I went against type. I went in and I knew that they wanted sexy. I kind of had an inside, you know, my agent found a little bit more inside information. So I wore like a really low cut dress. I went for it. I went opposite of what I've been trying to do. I'd always been trying to play the girl next door, which never worked for me. And I just, you know, brought a blow dryer with me and pretended like I was blow drying my hair, or maybe I turned it on. I can't remember if I did or not. I just know I had a blow dryer with me and I just went for it. And, you know, about a month later, I didn't hear right away. They called and told me that it's yours. And it was very exciting. You know, it was, you know, every year I had to sign a new contract, but it was, I ended up on there 8 years or just about 8 years. So
well,
very cool.
I want to bring up some of the acting stuff in a minute, but with this show, what were some of the funniest moments that you had hosting, but also what do you think were some of the worst movies you possibly showed?
Oh God. I don't know. Can you really pick out the worst of the worst? I mean, some of the people, you know, people love those films. They've become like iconic through the years. But you know, funniest moments. I mean, I did 450 shows. We never were down. We worked every week. So the show was never, you know, we didn't have seasons basically. So funny stuff. I mean, one time my top fell off, you know, or went down, you know, I had like a little, wardrobe malfunction, different things through the years. I mean, I interviewed everyone. I mean, from Barbara Walters to Max von Sydow, to Stevie Nicks, you know, Weird Al Yankovic, movie stars. I mean, just, you know, Alan Alda. I mean, the list went on and on of the type of people that I interviewed, along with just, we also did acting bits. And in my last year, we did a lot of tributes to, like, I Love Lucy. We called it I Love Rhonda, but you know, we did The Honeymooners and Bewitched and all the shows that I grew up with. So I actually got, the show had different, almost a different producer every year. And I've remained friendly with most of those producers, and each one had their own take on how they saw me. Although I tried to maintain the character that USA hired me for. And, you know, which was that common thread, but you know, the early years were very sexy and in lingerie and in a bedroom setting. And out on the town in LA, kind of a combination. And through the years, it subtly changed. Including the last 3 years that were done in New York. And so those became a little edgier, a little hipper, but still a little less of the bimbo high pitched character, but still very Rhonda-esque. In terms of the worst films, I can't even, they were all so bad. I mean, there were some really bad ones. I can't even remember the titles of. They were just total clunkers. But, you know, then I get all these fans that say, I loved all those films. You know, Attack of the Killer Bimbos, Attack of the Killer Tomatoes. I don't know. There's like crazy. I can't even remember, you know, Bikini Car Wash. But, you know, we're trying to reboot it on our own. So we already have rights to about 6 films that were part of the Up All Night library. Don't ask me the names right now, because I'd have to ask my new producer, who's gathering those through producer friends like Richard Gabay and other people like that, that are allowing us to use their, and, you know, to stream these films that were iconic back in the day.
Yeah. And speaking of having fun with some of the things you did on the show, you actually had on a few times a friend of us, or a friend of the show, yeah. Our show is Linnea Quigley,
who is
just super awesome. And it's awesome what she does with the animals and everything.
She's been a friend for years. She was definitely one of my, you know, regulars. And she did the show quite frequently, especially, well, in our LA year, she was on all the time. And fans love her. They still love her. I've put her on my own little web show that I do on Saturday night. So, yeah, I love her. She's awesome. I mean, from the animals to just her heart and the fact that she forever remains youthful and is able to still, you know, she moved to Florida for quite a few years, but she's back in LA in her element and filming and doing, you know, shoots again. So that makes me really happy for her.
Yeah. Had a chance to talk to her again last Saturday night because we were doing a virtual fundraiser and she jumped on and she's just one of the best.
She truly is. I mean, she's never been big-headed, or she's never let any of it go to her head, yet she has a huge fan base. I'm hoping to be participating, you know, once we get past COVID or we all get vaccinated, in some of the conventions that I hadn't done. But the Comic-Cons have just done so well. And I think that's just something I would like to do more in the future myself, including like one called Wizard World. I'm sure you may be familiar with it, but Wizard World, I spoke to the people that run that, and they were like, I would really like to have you part of our family. So I think that those things just get bigger and bigger through the years.
Yeah, exactly. And be a great way to hawk your book. And I mean that with all respect, which is awesome.
Well, yeah, thank you. Well, I have a lot of other products too. You know,
yes, not besides only my own,
intimate apparel, but because if we do what we're doing with Up All Night and that we get that back up, we'll be having just a lot more fan paraphernalia and you know, t-shirts and, you know, just really good stuff. So we're already looking into that. But besides, I've been dabbling with a cooking show, and we're already producing some, you know, cookware and spoons and bowls and things like that. So there'll be a lot. And actually the Wizard World people talked to me about selling, because a good friend of mine is Cato Kaelin, and Cato is the host of Wizard World. Yeah. And they love him. And he's if anybody can hawk, it's Cato. And he sells a lot of product for them, just in general, for Wizard World's, you know, product. So, you know, I said, hey, Cato and I, we have a line. We actually have a line with Cato that it's kind of been dormant, but we're gonna reboot that. And it's called Slackerwear, and it's men's loungewear. So a lot of things that we have on the back burner right now that that could, you know, it's really COVID holding us back. Once we if we, you know, feel a little bit safe, we'll be able to really hit the ground running. We're definitely geared up for all this stuff right now. So it's
definitely
exciting times.
You beat me to the punch with that hitting the ground running. But yeah. The one thing I wanted to bring up was WrestleMania 10 in New York City.
Yes.
Many fans, wrestling fans and fans in general, remember that. Were you approached by the company or USA to be a part of that?
Well, both. I had done a lot because it was WWE then. Is that what it was? Or is it WWE now? Whatever it was then. World Wrestling, whatever it was. Anyway, it was USA Network who they were in partnership with. So they aired everything. So even their lesser fights, you know, not the big annual one. So I covered a lot of those for my show, for Up All Night. And I had a lot of the wrestlers on. So there was a lot of cross promotion as well. And anyway, when WrestleMania 10 came about, it was really a combination of WrestleMania, because they got to know me. So the people, you know, I don't remember names now, but the people involved with WrestleMania just thought I would be a good fit. And it, again, would be a cross promotion with USA and WrestleMania. So it was really cool. The money was good. I got to work with Burt Reynolds and a few other people. And to this day, it's one of the most requested autographs I get. That and the one line that I had in Mel Brooks's Spaceballs. You know, one line. And people like go crazy over that. So it's kind of wild.
Yeah. Well, speaking of that, and you've hinted at it at the early part of this that we got taped, and just within the past few minutes, the acting. Obviously, Spaceballs, one of my favorite films of all time. I love anything of Mel Brooks.
Yes.
But, speaking of it.
He cast every part in that film. Well, I mean, I can only speak for Spaceballs. Was the only thing I ever went out for that was a Mel Brooks production. But he used a lot of comics and stand-ups in that particular film. And I actually got a lot of, I don't know how I got in, but I think I knew the casting director, not that helped or anything, but he said, called and asked me if I knew stand-ups for different parts. And I gave him a lot of names. So I got a lot of people in the door and a few people cast. But for myself, I had read for the waitress part and he liked me. And Mel actually he doesn't let a casting director at the time, you had to read for Mel Brooks. So that was pretty cool. You know, you weren't just reading for some person that passed it on to the producers. And so he cast even the smallest, every line in there, Mel Brooks, it was his okay. So I read for the waitress. At the time, I was a brunette with my natural hair color, and he wanted a blonde. And I'm like, well, I can easily wear a wig. And he's like, no, just, I really like you. I'm going to find something for you. Just show up. They'll call you on your day. You just come in and I'll find something for you. And so basically it was a throwaway line at the diner, and it was one line, and I was there all day in that the dining scene, and it was very cool to work with or near John Candy. Anyway, I didn't have direct lines with him, obviously, but very, very cool, and still very remembered by fans.
Yeah,
people memorize every line in the film, so they like know, or they feel like they know it intimately.
Are we talking now or then now?
and now, but actually now more than then now, because I think more people of all ages have an appreciation for that. I mean, it became a cult fame, you know, famous film. I mean, I literally have friends that know every line in it, which is just crazy to me, but I know people. That's
yeah.
What it's all about.
Well, and you know what? You probably notice is just as much as I do. Well, first off, I'm sure it helped that your good friend we talked about previously, Miss Joan Rivers, was a part of the project.
Yes.
But
yes,
also,
and that was before I knew her. I mean, I didn't get to work with her because those scenes were all differently, and I was only one day on the set. It was, you know, it was completely the diner scene. But that was before I knew her, and I actually met Joan Rivers in a cosmetic surgeon's office.
That's what we talked about. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. So that was my first meeting. So that was pre-cosmetic surgery. But anyway, it was cool that she was in it, and then I got to know her, and then obviously through the years, better and better. So I just love her.
Yeah, but what I was going to say there as well is that it's also, and you probably would agree with me, that any of Mel's projects that are well known, Spaceballs and Blazing Saddles, and you know, you go through the list, with today's culture and society, sure as hell probably couldn't make them.
Oh, you couldn't make them. Oh no, the politically correct stuff you're talking about.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, you couldn't touch any of it. Those lines, Blazing Saddles. No, sadly. Sadly, because I mean, there's no one more liberal, there's no one more, you know, progressive than Mel Brooks. And yet everyone, to my chagrin, has just taken everything a little bit too seriously, because that doesn't mean that you are not open and love all people. And one of my dogs is out, and she shouldn't be out. Okay, let me get this little one. Okay, sorry, I'm here. I just saw this little thing go by my window, and like, she was looking for me, and I'm looking for her. I'm like, she's too small to be out.
Sounds like my nephew, who's like a year and a half, and he gives you the innocent look, but he's doing something he knows he's not supposed to be doing.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, but this one's so small that, you know, we live on the water, and literally a hawk could take her away, and that terrifies me. So anyway, she's in. All's good.
All is good.
But all is well.
I was also asked a fan question. Gilbert Gottfried.
Yes.
On a few things that you worked together. Mm-hmm. Did you guys get along pretty good?
Oh, yeah. I mean, he was always sarcastic. He treated me like a sister, you know. We had that kind of sister-brother relationship, and he was incredibly cheap. So he, like, back in the day, you know, it was before cell phones when we first started, or maybe there were cell phones, but no one had them. But you used pay phones. And I remember Gilbert go, yeah, do you have a quarter? I need to make a phone call. I mean, like, Gilbert, you're really rich. I'm struggling here. You're in films. But he was just so funny. And I never thought he'd marry, because I always heard he lived with his mom. And then he married the loveliest woman who I, you know, we're Facebook friends, and we've talked on the phone, and, you know, through the years. And they're actually living in Florida at the moment. I mean, through the pandemic. But yeah, he's a great guy. He's very different. You know, he's very quiet off, you know, stage, but I mean, one of the bluest, dirtiest comics, but what a brain. I mean, his brain is amazing. You know, so if you go find it, there's definitely a podcast. I did one of his first podcasts. I know his podcast is extremely popular, and I was on one of his early ones, and it is dirty. It is dirty. So you got to go find the Rhonda Shear and Gilbert Gottfried podcast. It's funny.
Yeah, unfortunately, he's one of those guys with the whole PC thing we were just talking about has affected.
You think so? Because, I mean, let's see. I saw him perform live. It's probably been about 3 years ago here in town, and he was the same. But I can't imagine. I don't know. Maybe so. I don't know. a lot of, yeah, I guess some of his material I'd have to be careful with, but yeah. I don't know how to do stand-up comedy anymore. I mean, I would have trouble with it. Although my act was pretty much based on relationships, but it would still be things that today, if I just read, you know, found my act somewhere and looked at it, there'd be things I couldn't say for sure.
Oh, absolutely. You know, it's just like people got to realize jokes are jokes are jokes. I guess that's the best way to put it.
Exactly. That's what they are. And I think that the world needs to lighten up a little bit. I think we've all taken ourselves too seriously. And I think that's why this country is actually so divided, because if you can't laugh together, then you can't talk, you know? So, I mean, it's just too, you know, and you start taking words out of our vocabulary, I mean, legitimate words, not slang, but legit words, and saying you can't use them, like yeah. he, she, I mean, I'm, you know, maybe it's my age showing here, but I just can't wrap my head around that.
That, and the other thing I would think is too, and I could be wrong sometimes, yes, there's right and wrong and all that, but context of what is right. being discussed.
Exactly. Well, that's it. I mean, you know, the whole thing that's so great about comedy is that a comic usually is speaking not just the truth, but it's also what everybody's thinking in their deepest, darkest part of their mind. But, you know, they don't have the humor to say it, but it's what they're thinking. And that's why everybody relates to it. But when you start to suppress that kind of even humor or deep thoughts, then I think it's just very, it's like telling a kid, you know, you can never, ever drink ever, you know, an 18, don't you ever take a drink. Well, you know, the kid's going to go out with his friends and take a drink and then mm-hmm. maybe do more because it's forbidden. So to me, anything that's completely forbidden will backfire eventually.
Exactly.
So it's like a volcano ready to explode. And I think, you know, I've had friends that tell me, oh, my parents let me drink at the table with them. But so they never cared that much for alcohol or they were never addicted or anything because it was never taboo to them.
Exactly. But would you say, and we've talked about this previously as well, can everybody find you at the social distancing social hour website?
Yes. Yes. I, you know, I took a few weeks off during the holidays. I mean, we were off live, but I go back tomorrow live. But and I have Judy Tenuta as my guest tomorrow, and I'll be doing some cooking and interviewing, and just I'm mixing up the show more on the social hour. I think it's more fun to not to just do interviews and straight interviews, but also just, you know, whatever I'm in the mood for. So tomorrow I'm going to be doing a Super Bowl snack and you know, and cooking and chatting. So I think it's just fun. So yes, that's every Saturday night. We moved to 9 p.m., but we'll be moving back to 8 p.m. pretty soon.
Well, people can check it out, Rhonda Shear's socialhour.com. Mm-hmm.
And exactly.
What would be the link for if they are interested in buying the other products, whether it be your book and or the lingerie?
Oh, you can just go to rhondashear.com. It's really easy. And, you know, that'll, you know, tell our story and link you to even cool things like masks and the book and, of course, intimate apparel and loungewear. Great sales. We're always running fabulous sales. And, you know, and then Rhonda Shear Social Hour too will also link you back to rhondashear.com. And you can see our past episodes on rhondashearsocialhour.com, or you can watch us on Facebook, you can watch us on Twitter Live. You can watch us on rhondashearsocialhour.com. So having a blast doing that. And I'm looking forward to it. It's almost, I feel like we took a hiatus and now we're going back into season.
Well, there's many, many things that happened over at Shear Enterprises. That is for sure.
Yes, we have so many things on the burner right now, even, you know, working on products for other people. So maybe they can get them to market. We've got a pillow right now that we're working with a comic. I won't mention his name, but he's a well-known comic. We had a sitcom for many years. We're working on a machine for the abs with a friend of mine who's a stand-up comic, but he's a workout freak, so he invented a really cool, easy ab, I'll be calling it a machine, equipment, I'll call it equipment, to tighten up your abs at home. And so, you know, along with producing products for ourselves, sometimes when we feel like it's the right product, we help other people too get to market. So a lot of fun right now.
Well, make sure everybody gets to check out the sites and
thank you.
The video feeds, both live and taped, and just go check out.
Thank you. And hopefully you'll see me at more Comic Cons this you know, coming year. Well, I'm saying when we get past this, as I call it, the plague. And I definitely want to be part of that world. So I think it's just ripe for where I am even at this point. And I just signed with a new agency in LA, a new theatrical commercial agent. So I love them. They're really cool. They look for parts for all ages, for all types. And I had to audition for them as though I was auditioning for a role. It was very cool. And a friend of mine said, really, do you want to do that at this point? You've been around so long. I'm like, no, I think that's really good. They need to know if I'm capable of doing a cold reading. That's what happens when you read for parts. And anyway, I have a new agent. So hopefully you'll be seeing me in some TV and film upcoming. And
like you said, with the Wizard Worlds and the different conventions and stuff like that, I do think the fans will actually go apeshit to see you out on that circuit because you haven't been out there.
Now I know. And it's time. It's actually more time than ever. And I think it'll be just perfect for all the things that I'm doing in my personal life and our business life too. I think they're going to eat it up along with the rebooting of a lot of things that, you know, I'm working with. And the cool thing is that, just like, you know, with Zoom, you can really stream and do your own thing. And then maybe a network will pick it up. Maybe not. And even if they don't, you can just do it on your own. I mean, I do have my own Roku channel. It's not up to date at the moment, but we will be revving that back up and putting on everything that we're talking about. So I think there's lots to look forward to in 2021 and onward.
Upward and onward, that's for sure.
Thank you.
Rhonda, thank you so much.
Not all football helmets are created equal. Zenith, the industry leader in protective technology, is the only helmet in the game with adaptive head protection featuring a shock suspension system that can move independently from the helmet shell. Headquartered and developed in Detroit, Zenith is committed to player safety and revolutionary innovation. Zenith is proud to protect athletes at every level from peewee to the pros. Learn more about the Zenith difference at zenith.com. That's XENITH.com.
With over 30 years of experience and a superb reputation for being a detail-oriented company, Lacey Cleaning has some of the highest work standards in the cleaning business.
That's the fact, Jack!
Whether it's carpet cleaning, tile, grout cleaning, new construction cleanup, rental turnovers, vent and duct cleaning, odor elimination, office and or business cleaning, power washing, residential cleaning, you name it, they do it. Woo! Check them out. To contact them today, lacycleaning@gmail.com or call them at 609-709-8536.
And that's what I'm talking about.
I'm Linnea Quigley. I'm a scream queen. And I'm on Crazy Train Radio. Listen if you dare.